for all verified facts. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and click the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hello and welcome. In the last 24 hours, about 40,000 new cases of COVID-19 have been found in India. This is the highest since the 29th of November 2020. And that is, of course, worrying more so because the cases have begun to rise somewhat more sharply in the last 3 weeks than ever before. Now, among the states, the state of Maharashtra has had the highest, 25,833 as of the evening of 18th of March. Now, this is significant because this is the highest since the pandemic started. Similarly, in the city of Mumbai, it's almost 2,878, almost 2,900 cases, again, as of 18 March evening, which again is a record of sorts and not a record that we are surely happy about. Now, many other states are also seeing high cases: Punjab, Gujarat, Kerala, Karnataka, and Chhattisgarh. So why are the cases surging in this form? What do we understand, or have we understood more about the disease, the virus or the disease's behavior this time compared to last time? And are we better prepared in any way, though the numbers are much higher? And how could we be potentially arming ourselves to fight this long battle? Why is this happening? How is it different this time? Are we better prepared? Because all the initial evidence or the anecdotal reports in the last couple of days suggest that hospitals are already experiencing pressure. Doctors are seeing far more patients, though the patients, they themselves may not be as serious as perhaps they were in the first round. So let's try and understand this a little better, and also eventually, of course, what could we be doing and should we be doing at this point at a public health level as well as at a personal level to keep ourselves safe. To discuss this, I'm joined now by Dr. Gunjan Chanchalani, consultant intensivist at the Kambala Hill and St. Elizabeth Hospital in Mumbai. I'm also joined by Dr. Ishwar Gilada, consultant in HIV and infectious diseases at the Unison Medicare and Research Center also in Mumbai. Thank you both for joining me. Let me begin with you, Dr. Chanchalani. What have you been seeing? I spoke to you about 7 or 8 months ago. At that time, we were pretty much close to the peak, and there was a lot of concern and panic around. Now, that panic may not be there today, but the number of cases, as we just spoke about, is much higher.
Yeah, the cases definitely are increasing over the last couple of weeks, and they have been actually rising, skyrocketing, as you have said. And probably we are not at the peak. The cases may go up a little more. The reason being that there is no lockdown now, and people have actually kind of, you know, taken the whole thing quite in a relaxed manner. Maybe because the media hype again is not much, there is no lockdown, there is no message from the PM. So the scare in the people is less, and plus everybody has incurred some or the other loss in the last 1 year. So for them, earning and making up for those loss or giving their family a priority from monetary benefit side is more important. So they have been kind of neglecting the disease, and if you go out, even if it is an important to go out and work, they are not even following the basic public precautions that need to be taken there. Like even wearing a mask, even though the bus is crowded, there is more than 50% people will not be wearing a mask. Even on the roads in a crowded place, many people are not wearing a mask. They are very close to each other. So that is the worst thing. So cases may increase much more rapidly. And though we are wiser from the previous wave, that we know what works, we know where to catch the patient or when to refer to the hospital, we know when to do a CT scan, though we may get wiser, but still we may kind of, you know, not have enough health capacity, and the death rate may actually go higher than what we got it in the first wave. So that is what is the main worry right now.
And tell us about the patients that you are now seeing. I'm talking about fresh COVID cases versus what you were seeing in let's say the March to September phase or the April to September phase 2020. Any difference in the nature of symptoms and of course at the time at which they're coming in?
The time that they are coming in is comparatively a little later now, I would say that, because as I said, many people are neglecting the symptoms. The main symptoms that majority of them get is probably a little fever and malaise. So people, initially, there was a panic. So like first episode of fever and people would contact the doctor and, you know, start taking precautions, stop going out, be away from the family and, you know, isolate them in a room if possible and everything. But now since the panic has reduced, all this is not happening. So they are coming to the hospital a little later, but not really that late as it could, because even every doctor in the community is now educated about what to do when a COVID happens. But the one thing that I am seeing is that the lung involvement in this wave is probably a little earlier than what it was. Like earlier when we would do CT scans on the third or fourth day of the illness, we would many a times not find any lung involvement, and that would be seen probably at the end of the first week of the early second week. But now here, when they come to us with a CT scan done on day 3, day 2, there is already a lung involvement which is there. So that probably shows that in this wave, the variant of the virus that is there is involving the lung a little faster than what it was in the first wave.
Okay, and I'm going to come to you on for some explanation on that. But Dr. Gilada, tell us, I mean, you've been tracking many infectious diseases, including HIV in the past. What are you seeing in the way this has progressed between March of last year and now, even as we finish a year now?
What we clearly understand is human behavior and the virus behavior, they are both unpredictable. Actually, after all this kind of pandemic, whole year is gone, lot of economic impact, people should have understood. As Gunjan said, people are not behaving properly. The COVID-specific behavior is not there. Today morning, I did one survey at the Worli CFS, and which is almost 6 months after I had done that. And I find the same thing, actually worse than what it was 6 months back, when it was the peak of the epidemic. So 40% people wearing mask, but 20% people are not wearing properly. So in reality, 80% people are not wearing mask. That to what we are talking, Worli CFS means quite a well-being, well-startup society, health-conscious people, middle-aged group people, and they are not wearing masks. So if that is a behavior, we are going to face a problem. And that we started seeing. The only saving grace, as Gunjan said, that our health preparedness is proper, much better than earlier. Our oxygen bed, our ICU bed, ventilators are in plenty. Medicines are available. Doctors' understanding is much better than earlier. So they know what to use, what not to use. And most important is this current strain of the virus is super spreader, but it is not killer. So our case fatality rate has come down to 0.7, which used to be 3.5 earlier in Mumbai. It came down to 2.5 or so, then 1.5, but currently it is 0.7. So this is the situation.
Right. And in your understanding, why is it this why is this happening now? Now, people, I guess, started becoming careless since December or January. And yet we saw or are seeing this sudden spurt from about 300 cases in the city of Mumbai, for instance, to almost 2,500 plus cases, all in the matter of weeks. So what could have triggered this sudden change or sudden spurt?
Actually, those who are observing for last 1 month or so, it is not sudden. It is happening slowly. But what happens is, one becomes two, it is only one increase. But when two becomes four, this two increase. So likewise, it is increasing more. When you see this spurt now, you go back at least 1 month, 1.5 months. Lot of marriages happening, lot of social gatherings happening. There was a lockdown fatigue. People want to meet their relatives. Even my family member would like to come and see me, which they have not done so far 1 year. So that much is there. And then there's a news that vaccine has come. Vaccine has come, but vaccine has not come in your arm. So just vaccine has come on paper, it doesn't mean any vaccination. And that way, the speed of vaccination is also not as good as it should have been. When particularly India is a world producer of the vaccine, plenty of vaccines are available, plenty of vaccinators are available, but they are not utilized. So I think we need to look at several issues, and they are multifactorial. And what we'll see in next couple of months or so is five states which are election mode states. There is no social distancing, there is no masking, right from top leader to the bottom leader. So we are going to see, there is also Kumbh Mela going on in Haridwar, where social distancing is not possible, and you cannot use mask when you are taking a dip in Ganga.
Right, but the cases, at least at this point, and going by the data that we have, seem to be spiking only in some parts of the country, which is, and more so in Maharashtra, and maybe a few other states. But Maharashtra seems to have led the race, so to speak. So if there is a behavior change all over the country, if there are, let's say, polls happening in other parts of the country, so why is it that cases are spurting here? I'm just trying to understand if we can understand how this virus could potentially spread and whether there are lessons from that.
As I said in the beginning, the virus behavior is unpredictable. What we are seeing, these so-called Bimaru states, Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan and UP. If you single out two states, Bihar and UP, you find their rate is so low and all along it is low. So there is something which is in the poorer states. There is something where the health parameters are very poor. There is something where all along the death rate is low. In Bihar, death rate is 0.6% all along. So either we have to prove that what data they are giving is wrong, or we have to follow them. Every time Maharashtra cannot be leader for the whole world or whole country. They sometimes even Bihar and UP can be leader. So I would like to suggest that there should be some serious study to be done, both by administrators and scientific community, to see what is good in those two states where it is not escalating, despite a lot of exodus of people who went from here, migrant who went back. Despite that, they have curtailed, maybe they have taken early lockdown, administrative machinery, whatever they have done well.
Right. Okay. And I mean, some of the epidemiologists I've been talking to have been saying that because they're more rural and maybe there is more dispersion of population, that could be one reason why it's not spread as much. Dr. Chanchalani, let me come back to you. You talked about, you know, an early lung infection or an impact on the lung. Could you tell us a little more about what that means and how it plays out or is playing out?
So they see COVID actually, the phases of COVID that are there. So that's the first phase, which is more like a viral illness. That means it is more like a regular flu or anything. And then it comes to the second phase, where is the immunogenic phase, wherein the virus creates a immunogenic reaction in the body, which affects the lungs. So this is what was the pathophysiology that has been, we have been reading all this while. And where it says that by that end of first week or the beginning of second week is when the lung gets involved, when this immunogenic phase starts and when the oxygenation starts dipping. So earlier, when we would do the scans in the first week, most of the time the first week scans would be normal, the third or fourth day scans that would we would have. But then now when we are doing the scans, because people have realized that CT scan is probably the faster way to detect a COVID infection, which has involved the lungs. So now people are coming to us with the scans. So earlier people would come to us probably a little later also, and we would scan them in the second week, and we would most of the time not find any infection in the first week. So even if we did it, now people are coming up with a scan where the third day or the fourth day itself, they have a lung involvement, though their oxygenation is maintained. And probably many of them will not have an oxygen dip and they may recover with that itself. So even in mild disease, now we are seeing kind of a lung involvement, which I would have not scanned in the first wave at all. So now they are actually, since the community has realized that scan is more important, so people are doing more and more scans, and maybe that is one of the reasons why it would. But then, as I can say, with my experience that I saw in the first wave is that in the first week also, when we would scan somebody, we would not find any lung involvement. But now we are finding a lung involvement. I do not understand. Maybe it's the new variant. But then again, I am not the right person for this. There should be a probably a good genetic study to find out whether this is a new variant that is causing it, or whether it's a human body's reaction which is causing it.
But okay, so what is this leading to? I mean, again, in your experience, patients that you've seen or you've treated yourself, or you've seen being treated around you, what's happening? What happens after this?
So when the lung gets affected, so more and more percentage of the lung getting involved, the oxygenation will dip. So that is what why the lung involvement is very important. And most of the deaths that occur are because of the oxygenation dip. So the lung involvement probably is a kind of a sign which tells us that I need to be more cautious about this patient, observe him more carefully. And if the patient continues to spike beyond the 4th, 5th or 6th day, I would probably want to treat him with steroids or do a repeat scan to see how if the spread is increasing, and probably treat him with antiviral like remdesivir or something. But as sir said, this time the fatality that we are seeing in the second wave is lesser. Despite this being there, is probably now we are more prepared, and probably till about a week or 10 days back, we had empty beds in every hospital. That is the main thing. So when there are empty beds, and like people had come out of that burnout that they had gone through. So till September end, October, everybody was overworked. And now the doctors and the nurses have had some amount of relaxation period, though they are not mentally prepared for a second wave. But still, treating the patient for them is not a real challenge now. They are kind of prepared what is to be done, how it is to be taken care. And that could be the reason. But as the number of cases increase, and when the hospital gets overwhelmed and people get overworked, I am sure probably the fatality rate may go much higher than the first wave. Because this time, this virus, as Dr. Ishwar sir said, that it is spreading more faster than what it was. It could be human behavior related, or it could be the genes of the virus itself. Again, we do not know. We need to study this further to know that.
Right. And Dr. Gilada, you know, this has been pointed out by many people that some of the newer variants, whether it's the South African variant, UK variant, another variant, they spread faster. Now, can you explain to us once again what that means? When they say that it's more infectious, but not necessarily more impactful.
Yeah, basically, the virus has two qualities. One is a spreading factor, and one is a lethal factor. So currently what we see is a spreading faster and sparing people from death, sparing people from critical illness. And if that is the case, then we should be looking at our own variant, because what we have seen that whatever studies are done, South African, Brazilian, or UK strains are not found in much number. And as a habit, we got to in a habit of blaming others rather than looking at our own strains. So there are some different strains found in Amravati, Nagpur, or Jalgaon, and Akola. I think we should study that. And secondly, what we need to do is don't count Maharashtra because Maharashtra's population is high. It is only comparable to Bihar, but a lot of other states are low. So we should talk about per million population, what are the infections? And in that per million population, currently Maharashtra is at number 7. There may be smaller states like Goa or Union Territory like Ladakh, Delhi, Kerala, Puducherry, Chandigarh, then Maharashtra. And when you look at even district-wise also, per million district, in that also, Mumbai is 24th. So there are a lot of districts ahead of us. So I think we should not look at only real numbers.
Right.
We should look at real new infections, per million infections, and per million deaths. And that is the way we should look at. Most important thing is, as Honorable Prime Minister said about 6-8 months back, if we are able to bring down the death rate to less than 1, we have won the half war. And I think we have brought that to 0.7%. There are a lot of flus where death rate is 0.5%. So we don't do lockdown. We don't panic about them. So if
when we say that we are getting worried, and let's say for the city of Mumbai, we say it's now almost 2,800 cases. We are only comparing with Mumbai city last year. I know you're right about the per capita, but we're only comparing with the same city at a different time.
Yeah, you see, last year there were no locals. Now local is opened up. What we said, we suggested that you cannot stop local, but you ask people, those who want to travel on local, use a shield. So apart from face mask, if there's a face shield, there's a double protection. And that has been proved scientifically. So when you are opening up, you must put some condition people are willing to follow. If they want to earn their livelihood, they are willing to follow those kind of conditions. But currently, there is nothing followed up there.
Right. Right. Okay. Dr. Chanchalani, as we now look ahead, who are the kinds of people who are more at risk? Any changes in that? And therefore, who should be more careful? And secondly, how strong are we or secure are we in terms of our medical response, in terms of the medicines that we are offering, and then I'll come to the vaccines later. But in terms of the medical response and in terms of who is more susceptible, your sense at this point?
So from India, we don't have any such study to show that who is more susceptible in the second wave per se. But in the first wave, yes, elderly were more susceptible. People who are obese, people who had diabetes, hypertension, these were more susceptible. But if you see studies from abroad, which are there, they have shown that in their countries, the children were more affected, though the mortality was not very significant, even in the first wave, also in the second wave. And also they found that the pregnant patients were more at risk as compared to, they found more pregnant with COVID rather than in the previous wave. So I really, in the India, we don't have, I think the risk factors will remain the same. The elderly and the young people or the pregnant people who have compromised immunity, especially obese and diabetes, we saw a very bad response or a very severe disease in diabetics and obese right. people in the first wave. I think that continues to be there. And any comorbidity, whether it is hypertension, diabetes or heart disease or kidney disease, all these people are more susceptible to get a severe disease and they need to continue to be more cautious about their health and, you know, avoid crowded places and use maybe double protection like Dr. Ishwar said, that we need to use a mask as well as a face shield because it gives almost near complete protection if you are using that. Okay, I think the main reason why face shield would give a protection is it prevents you also from touching your face repeatedly, from adjusting your mask and everything, because the virus also tends to spread through fomites. So it may be there in your hand and you may touch your face or your eyes and it spreads through that. So if you're wearing a face shield, it protects you itself from touching your face repeatedly and preventing you from getting infected. That could be one reason that could be there. So they need to continue that. About the medical response, as I said, currently, yes, we are prepared as we are out from the burnout. And, you know, we are kind of fresh to work again. And plus, we have enough stock of medications for now. But as I said, as the cases will increase and the severe cases will increase, maybe we will not be prepared and maybe we may have see a worser outcome than what we saw in the previous wave. We need to, probably the Indian government need to, you know, stock up this. Last time, we even had a shortage of steroids for a very small phase. So all these medications need to be stocked up by the Indian government so that we don't have a shortage of antiviral drugs and steroids and everything.
But are you saying that we are headed to a shortage right now?
We may. I don't know. Maybe if the way, because this virus tends to spread very faster and more faster. And as you say, if even if a young person is going out to work, he may not get a severe disease, but he may come home to give his parents or somebody who's more immunocompromised to give the disease. And once it's in the house, everybody in the family is affected. Now people are going out, not just for work, they are even going out on outings, like birthday parties, small get together. So that is going to spread more faster. So we need to be prepared for the worser kind of a wave, worser peak than what we saw last time.
Right, we must be prepared. Dr. Gilada, last word to you. We are also obviously rolling out a vaccine. The vaccine is right now for 60 plus or those with comorbidities between 45 and 60. It's a bit of a slow start. A lot of people, as we all know, are not taking the vaccine despite being eligible for it. So how do you see this this evolving now? I mean, as more people take the vaccine, will we be able to create some level of herd immunity or some level, not the absolute number, but or will the virus potentially, as things are going, move much faster and therefore render this whole vaccine effort somewhat ineffective, at least for now?
There are two things. One is, in principle, who should be getting vaccine? Now, on one hand, we are blaming the 20 to 40 age group, that they are the culprit, they are bringing infection home, and they are the people who will be spreading the society. So on one hand, if we blame them, actually, our policy should be youth-centric. Why in HIV we are successful? Because rather than blaming young people, we put them in the program. They were made part of the program, and it was a youth-centric policy. So now also, if they are the breadwinner, they are the people who are going to get infection from here to there or there to here, they should be prioritized. We have no shortage of vaccine production. We have been able to supply to the rest of the world. So why should not we give them? And secondly, at that time, it was death rate was more in the comorbid people and old people. Now, if the death rate has settled to 0.7% from 3.5%, then we should be looking at spreading less. And if spreading less has to be there, then it has to be young people to be targeted. Now, looking at pace of vaccination, we have started very slowly. And there are very few centers. Centers do work only for 6-7 hours a day. The Saturday, Sunday, they don't work. They want to reconcile their effort. Actually, if you look at that, we are training those people which are not trained to give injections. And we are telling them how to fill up the syringe. And there's a lot of vaccine wastage, what Prime Minister also said. We should have, there are 12,50,000 MBBS doctors. I'm not even counting non-MBBS doctors. There are 3,70,000 postgraduate doctors. Even if out of these 16,000, 20% of them are used, there are 3 lakh doctors available for vaccination. 100 vaccine per day, it will count 3 crore per day. So all priority population can be finished in just 10 days. Now, why not open up vaccine at primary health centers, sub-centers? There are 23,000 PHCs and there are 1,47,000 sub-centers. So we have so many vaccination centers can start and it can reach villages. Currently, it is only in the cities and taluka places. Right. So we need to look at those issues. We should need to incentivize that if you are taking vaccine, after 2 weeks, you can travel. There will be a travel certificate. There should not be artificial requirement. If you are paying for vaccination, income tax rebate will be there. If you have corporate social responsibility, you can. So there are multiple ways of increasing vaccination and opening up. Everybody is not asking free vaccine. They don't want to spend 3 to 4 hours in vaccine queue. They want to get it from their own doctor in just 10 minutes, 15 minutes. And now we know that there is no need of waiting 30 minutes. There is no need of doing a lot of things what are currently done. And we can do it.
Right. Dr. Gilada, thank you very much for that. I think so. Effort both on the vaccine front, hopefully open it up to the younger category of people because they are mobile. And some countries like Indonesia are already doing that. Maybe we can follow, maybe we can't. But it's definitely something that we should be thinking about very actively now that cases are going up. And obviously, as Dr. Chanchalani says, we have to be alert. And particularly if you are already susceptible and perhaps some of those comorbidities, because the disease is very much within us. Thank you both for joining me, and I do wish you and your teams all the very best in the fight against this disease. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.